Good morning, members. We have already formed a quorum. It is also time to start. Thank you for coming to the meeting. As of the last meeting, for the term 2015-16, we approved 24 items of a value of $39.3259 billion. In relation to the five outstanding papers from the May 4th meeting, we have altogether 9 papers in relation to $26.0535 billion. If all the funding proposals are accepted by members today, the cumulative number of approved items will be 33, of a value of $65.3794 billion. Disregarding money for land resumption and computerization projects totaling $3.6972 billion, the works projects will involve a total of $61.6822 billion. We have a long agenda today, and for each item, it will be regarded as important. And I hope that members will act in accordance with our rules of procedures. That is, let's focus on the items themselves. For policy issues, well, please refrain from referring to them for discussion and have them deferred to panel meetings. Now, for the discussion items today, if you have direct and indirect pecuniary interest, please, in accordance with Rule 83A of the Rules of Procedures, disclose the nature of the interest before you speak. Please also note the provisions concerning voting in relation to matters that you have direct pecuniary interest under Rule 84. First item, PWC 2016-17-10-41QJ, Youth Hostel Scheme construction by the Hong Kong Federation of Youth Groups. The purpose of the paper is to upgrade 41QJ to Category A at an estimated cost of $150.9 million in month-of-the-day prices. We started the discussion last time. We carry on today. In attendance, we have a number of public officers. The name list is tabled, and I believe that the officers involved are the same as last time. So let's carry on with the questions last time. Two members were already waiting to ask questions last time. It appears that we have got more members wishing to ask questions today. Mr. Wu Chi-wai, for the first time, 4 minutes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, regarding the youth hostel scheme, we do not query the broad principles and we do not intend to object to the construction. However, there is a very important policy issue which was discussed at the panel meeting, but we haven't got any answer. We talk about the mandatory reserves. That's in paragraph 3 or item 3. There is the mandatory reserves, but when there is still money left, then it will be spent on supporting the other non-profit making users of the operating body. It provides a difficulty here. Now, it will be having young people living in the hostel. I think if you charge a lower rent, then they can have more savings. And then the public would have the perception that anything left, I mean, the balance of the rental income can be spent on supporting other users of the operating body. I don't think this is reasonable. This is because a construction cost will be borne by the government, so it comes from the public money. When rental income is received, if part of it is to be spent on supporting other users, of course, I know it will be subject to the HAB's approval. I think to a certain extent, it gives people an impression that for the young persons involved, they pay the rent, and in effect, part of the rent will become like a donation to the operating body. A young person may at most live there for 5 years, and then at most have the tenancy agreement renewed once only. So how can you make sure that there will be sufficient incentives for the young person to vacate the unit upon the expiry of the 5-year tenancy, and then have it vacated for other young people to move in? So for the operating balance, would you regard it as savings for the young tenants, so that upon departure from the hostel, the young person can get the money back, and then it can become the capital for him to, say, start a business, or a few young tenants can join together, and then they can pull together the money, and then they can start something new? Mr. Wu, as you have said, it is in relation to the policies, but still, I'd like to give the floor to the administration for a brief answer. Who will take the question? Well, as to whether the young tenants would be willing to leave after 5 years when the tenancy expires, we did discuss the matter with the operators. When they move in, we aren't just talking about a tenant-landlord relationship. We do have the perspective of youth development. The participating bodies will have a very active dialogue with the tenants. I'd like to defer it to my colleague. I think it's good enough if you give a brief reply. No need to defer it to others. Mr. Chairman, at the meeting of the Home Affairs panel, the question was asked but not answered. That's why I have to pursue it. Yes, exactly. I'm asking him to give an answer. I think he has the information, so I tried to ask him not to dodge the issue. Mr. Lam. During the tenancy, the young persons would have a very close relationship with the operator. They are aware of the 5-year tenancy duration, and then the tenancy can be renewed for 2 years and then 2 years. So they know what to do to get themselves ready to leave upon expiry of the tenancy. Well, should there be a surplus after the mandatory reserves? It is said that it will be spent on supporting other users. Well, we're going to have no frills designs, and then the operating bodies will operate on a cost-effective basis. Therefore, if we encourage them to run the hostel in a very efficient manner, and then for any surplus, it will be spent on maintenance, and then if there's still any money left, subject to the approval of the HAB, the money can be spent on non-profit making uses, but then we aren't talking about the routine ones. For the routine ones, they can get the subvention from the government. What we are having in mind is to make further improvements on the existing basis and to have something experimental. Now, the land belongs to the NGO itself. We need to give them incentives to take part in such a partnership. So in this way, we think this arrangement will make sure that the operation will be efficient, and then we can encourage the operating bodies to take part in the scheme so as to provide more places at the youth hostels to benefit the young people who are interested. Mr. Law, the HAB's approval would be needed. Would you say that the principle would mainly be that the money be spent on youth-related items? Well, we have got operating bodies from different backgrounds. Some of them are more sort of involved in youth group, while others may not have expertise in youth work, so we can't mandate it be spent on youth work. What we are saying is that, it is said that maybe we should consider a rent deduction. Should there still be a surplus after setting aside money for the maintenance? If the operator thinks that rent reduction is a good option, we won't stop it. Next, Mr. Ray Chen. 3 minutes, second round. I want to pursue the question about the level of rental. It is important, and at the FC meeting, I will still pursue this point. In paragraph 7, it is said that the rental will be set at a level which does not exceed 60% of the market rent. Why should it be pegged to the market rent? Would it be for reference, or does it mean that future adjustments will also be linked with the market rent levels? And I want to know why, if that is the case. Now, it is said that it is not a housing project, it is a youth development project. Now, for youth development work, I do think when you talk about the fees and charges, they should pack with the market levels. Now, it will be more expensive in Central and Xiaoman, cheaper in other places. It will be absurd if you have got such an arrangement. Now, for this particular hostel, it will be the first one to be completed, and it will be the first one to have intake of tenants. I think we need to impress upon the administration clearly that we don't want it to be set in accordance with the market rent. Can you give us a clear answer when we have it again at the FC meeting? Well, for the proposed rent levels, we are talking about flats of similar size and comparable flats. And then we talk about not exceeding 60% of the market rent. This is because the purpose is to enable young people to move into the youth hostels at concessionary rent. Rent levels vary from one district to another. I think during the development stage, and here we are talking about nurturing their sense of independence and their financial literacy, so this will be an important factor. Well, for the urban area, the rent levels will be higher, and then you have to pay a higher rent in the urban area than more remote areas. But still, in any event, they won't be paying more than 60% of the market rent. You say not more than, not higher than, so it can be lower than the 60% of the market rent, yes. Now, if you live in the urban area, of course, you have to bear in mind that if they choose to live in the urban area, it must be related to their workplace, or that they have to attend classes in the evening, or they may be able to save on the traveling expenses. I want to know whether future adjustments will also be packed to the market levels. When you make a start, of course, you have to pick a starting point. Now, you talk about not exceeding 60%, but what about future adjustments? Your time has run out, so a brief reply, please. First of all, not exceeding. Secondly, we're talking about running the project for decades, so we have to take into account the prevailing market rent levels.
Next, Mr. Lan Chi-Chang, 4 minutes. This is a PWSC meeting, but members have been talking about policies. As for the actual construction works, not many people have talked about that. As for rental level, I remember I did ask similar questions at a panel. Maybe Mr. Chen Chi-Chin didn't attend that meeting. Now, this is a dormitory built for young people. It is built to solve their housing problems, and it is hoped that after residing at such youth hostels, they can save enough money to buy their own properties afterwards. So when it comes to the facilities of the youth hostel, there should be a direction. If I'm a young person and if I live in a youth hostel, if the management committee keeps on coming to me asking me to do this and that, I think I won't like to live there. The Federation of Youth Groups may have more experience in this. So are you providing accommodation only or what? Under paragraph 4A, you say that there will be communal facilities, reading rooms, etc. So these facilities are provided, and you won't knock on their doors asking them if they would join certain activities. If I'm a young person and I live there, I don't like people knocking on my door all the time. So can you do more in terms of facilities? Can you build a gym or certain sports facilities, for example, a ping pong table? So can a hotel-like service be provided? About facilities, so who's going to answer that question? Ms. Amy Fong from the Hong Kong Federation of Youth Groups. Just now, you talked about services and facilities for young people. Last time I have also explained about it. Now for the Taipo Youth Hostel, at the lower floor, youth SPOT, a spot, will be reprovisioned. So this center caters for young people, and the young residents living upstairs can also enjoy such facilities and services. As for facilities, on the second and third floor, we will have certain facilities for the young people. For example, a reading corner, an internet space, a laundry, and simple gym equipment, etc. We will be providing these. When the young people living there have time, they can go to such communal areas and meet friends. No follow-up? Next. I'm sorry, the speaker is off mic. Well, can our screen show the names of members waiting to ask questions? You will be next, and then Ms. Sitho will be following you. Because members may have pressed button at the last meeting, but they are not here now. Mr. Wu Chi-wai. When I read paragraph 7 of the paper, it says that the rental will be set at a level which does not exceed 60% of the market rent. So if an NGO is providing a site in the urban area, then after deducting the operating cost, the NGO will get more money than those NGOs that are operating youth hostels in the rural areas or remote areas. So for this scheme, you want to encourage NGOs to provide their own sites, and then more youth hostels can be built. So for the whole scheme, the major incentive is to encourage NGOs to operate youth hostels, and then by operating such youth hostels, they can have a better cash flow. Is this the concept? If it is, we would ask whether it's the right or wrong concept. If not, would it be part of life planning for young people? Now, you are providing a place for them to live for 5 years, but after 5 years, when they have to leave, what do they get? So that they can have, to know that they are better off. For 5 years, can a young person become that well off? it is not easy for him to find another appropriate residence. Can you tell me if you have other ancillary plans other than allowing them to live at a youth hostel for 5 years? Well, this is mentioned in various parts of the paper. One of our policy objectives is to do this. That is, NGOs may have a number of sites, and if these sites are underutilized, they can join our scheme so that more youth hostel places can be provided to young people, and people all over the territory can benefit. Now, young people may need to work, and then after work, they may need to further their studies. So providing them with accommodations in different parts of the city is appropriate. And when it comes to youth development, just now, the Hong Kong Federation of Youth Groups has also mentioned this. That is, when young people move into youth hostels, it is hoped that they can broaden their network, and they would get to know people that may inspire them, or they may get to know friends so that together they may start some business. So in a youth hostel, they may get to know people who they can be long-term friends with. And also, youth development services will be provided at a youth hostels. Because this is a very important stage in their development. So if they are given such opportunities, it would be conducive to their personal growth. And it is also hoped that by paying less rents, they can save money during this period. And after living in a youth hostel for a period of time, they may have enough money to further their studies or even buy a property of their own. Next, Mr. James Toh, first round. Just now, Mr. Alan Leung says that he's going to attend another meeting. Do you mind him asking the question? Oh, it doesn't matter. Okay. Mr. James Toh. I would like to follow up on Mr. Ray Chen's questions. Well, for the paper, maybe next time you should make it clearer. You are saying, well, in Chinese, you're saying that the rental level should be comparable to 60% of the market rents, but in English, it does not exceed. So in Chinese, it's not clear enough. It may be higher than 60%. 60% of the market rent. So are you talking about the market rent of hostels or private properties? Mr. Laurie Low? Well, in paragraph 7, it says that it's the market rents of flats of similar size in a nearby area. So we're talking about the size. But what about the flats? Is it a private residential flat or a hostel? Well, there are not many hostels like this in the market, so we are comparing this to private residential markets. When you assess the value, you really have to look at the type of the flat. Okay, so you have been explained too. Just now, Mr. Ray Chen has asked about different districts. And if the nature of this is to provide a service, then we really have to think about the differences among districts. Now, if there is only a slight difference in rents, then I don't mind, but I think that's a huge difference. I remember there's this one in Mong Kok, and the difference is really big. So I hope that when it comes to the rental level, you should pay attention to this. You shouldn't be just looking at the market rents of flats in that district. Now, if this is a service provided to young people, you should really think about this. Now, there may be other subvented services, for example, youth centers, but that's not exactly like this. But the rental at other youth centers may not be so different among different districts. In more expensive areas, the rental is much higher. I am worried that the difference in rents is too high. So can you narrow the gap? That is, the rents in the urban areas may be too high. Yes, we understand. We are talking about flats of similar size in the nearby areas. And we are talking about very commonplace flats, not luxury flats. Well, even commonplace flats are very expensive because I am a member of the ULA. I know about this. Well, if we have to look at the reality. Two projects have been scrutinized here. For one project, the future rent may be $1,500, and for the other projects, it's $2,300. And we are targeting young people. Their median income is $12,000. So for these two projects we are talking about, the rent would just account for 12 to 19% of their income. This is affordable to them. But can you give me some more information? Let me cite an example. For Mongkok, how do you make the calculation? Can more information be provided concerning typical valuation? How do you evaluate flats? And if in different districts you adopt the same principle, members query, there may be problems. So please give us more information. Mr. Michael Tian, Chairman. I have a question. Well, the applicants, after moving into the youth hostel, even though he is queuing up for public housing, he has to give up that place. So we really have to think very clearly. That's young people who are not that well educated and they have very low income. And there are also university graduates who do not make much money at the moment. So the government says that now after young people who are moving into the youth hostels, they cannot apply for public housing. Well, of course, you are not seeing that these two groups of people are that different. But we know that a lot of young people who have less education and who have low incomes may want to move into youth hostels, and they may not have a bright future, and they may not afford market rent. And even if they queue up for a long time, they may not get a public housing unit. So if they can get a public housing unit, of course, they would give up their place in a youth hostel. And youth hostel has that age limit, that's 30 years old. But now their chance for getting a public housing unit is taken away. So for these young people who have less education and who have low income jobs, then you are depriving them of another opportunity. It is very likely that these young people may have to live in public housing for their whole life. If you have this policy, then what will happen to them after living for 5 years in a youth hostel? They cannot move back to subdivided flats. So it's very likely that your future tenants will be young university graduates.
So this criterion would result in a very odd position. There is those who are in most need of the hostel places will be deprived the chance. So I find it difficult to understand why you have this requirement, Mr. Law. Well, for this requirement, well, in fact, it was much discussed within the administration. Of course, we cannot just count on the youth hostel scheme to resolve all the problems related to youth housing. Among government departments and bureaus, when the matter was discussed, there was this clear vision that is both public housing and youth hostels would require huge public resources. So if we have got a one-person household or a two-person household, no, please do not repeat the requirement. Let me finish first. When you get your PRH unit, you will give up the youth hostel, right? Why can't you allow them to remain on the queue? Well, if a young person is applying for a youth hostel unit, and if you allow them to, he can also wait for his turn for PRH unit. Well, as long as somebody is in the queue, he can accumulate the points. So if a person is waiting for a youth hostel unit and he's also waiting for a PRH unit, now vis-a-vis others who are not qualified for youth hostel schemes, then it would be unfair. Therefore, we are saying that as soon as you get admitted to a youth hostel, you need to quit the waiting list for PRH. But of course, after leaving the youth hostel, if there's still the need, he may apply again for a PRH unit. Have a chance, 4 minutes. Now, this is something to help the young people for the short term, and it is something provisional. There's no reason that we should say no to it. However, there are two important issues. First, as raised by Michael Tian. Now, we shouldn't be polarizing the two. We are talking about transitional assistance. Why don't you allow them to wait for their PRH unit while they're in the hostel? Well, for the PRH unit, it is unlike the HOS unit, and you cannot resell the hostel place. So in terms of allocation of public resources, we aren't talking about one young person holding on to two units. The hostel place will be surrendered and allocated to somebody else. So it is nonsense for you to talk about unfairness. Now, for parents who are rich, they can buy a flat for their children, while other young people are forced to live in subdivided flats and live in very poor living conditions. Now, according to the current system, young people have to wait for more than 20 years before they get allocated a proper housing unit. So you are trying to smash their hopes. You are too rigid. You are too bureaucratic. If you don't rectify this, I'm afraid the young people will just continue to hurl bricks at you. So when you conceive a service, when you conceive a scheme, I've always asked the officials to make it a bit better for the young, for the people of Hong Kong. Please do not start conceiving any projects with bureaucracy only in your mind. Now, for the youth hostel, why can't you let them live in the youth hostel for a while waiting for their PRH allocation? So all the young people will just wait for their turn. Please wake up from your bureaucracy. Second, for the Hong Kong Federation of Youth Groups, I think it is money-making, and this annual report is not the audited report. We did ask for it, and still they couldn't explain. And it is sort of a semi-black hole. They have the privileged class. They have got transfer of interests. We know nothing about it. the public cannot know about it. So if you give it to the Hong Kong Federation of Youth Groups, I want to know whether somebody has made any money. We have no trust in this group. They're supposed to do youth work, but then their facilities are of a higher class. Have they done anything for the young people who held breaks in Mong Kok? In the 1980s, there was the unrest in Mong Kok and the central, and that's why the British Hong Kong government developed youth work. And the Hong Kong Federation of Youth Groups has got the largest number of young person groups. Now, I think the Federation of Youth Groups should take the blame for having this generation of young people who are hurling bricks in Mong Kok. So how can you assure us that the people in the Federation of Youth Groups will not benefit from this project? I think Albert Chen has aired his view. If the very last sentence is a question, so maybe Mr. Law can tell us how he's going to monitor the operators. Be brief, because the time has run out. For NGOs taking part in the Youth Hostel Scheme, they must sign a service agreement with us. And we do ask for an annual audited report of their financial matters. And it will be made public, and then the public can also take part in monitoring the performance. Sit hold, 3 minutes, second round. Mr. Chairman, the mic hasn't been switched on. We can hear you, all right. I have a series of questions. So that the administration and the service provider can provide more information to us. It is impossible to get answers if we've got 4 minutes and then 3 minutes, 2 minutes. First of all, income and expenditure. According to the paper, it is said that the rental will be set at a level which does not exceed 60% of the market rent in the nearby areas. I hope you will adopt the practice of the Urban Renewal Authority. Get a professional surveyor to find out about the market rent in the nearby areas. Take into account the facilities available, etc. Second, management and repair maintenance. What is the expected expenditure? This is because we are all concerned about the surplus. Now, the surplus can be used by the service provider in the future. We are against this arrangement. Now, the government is going to subsidize the project by paying for the construction costs. But then you are enabling the service operator to make a profit. This is unacceptable. I think you should follow either Mr. Wu's idea, or you have a seat money so that when the tenant leaves the hostel, he will pick up what has been saved. For this particular project, there will only be 78 units. And the scale would vary greatly when compared with the 1,200 places in the Poland Cooks project. I'm sure your management fees will be more expensive. Now, the market rent in the nearby areas will be different, and then the scale will be different. So I think the service agreements should be different. Otherwise, for a smaller project, if the scale differs, then the loophole for profit making will be larger. Sit hold. I think, as you have said, there may not be time for all the questions to be answered. Well, in fact, Mr. Law has promised to give a paper that is for the youth hostels in different districts. They can show you the market rent assessed. As they have said, the rental will be set at a level which does not exceed a particular level of the market rent. So the information will be forthcoming, and then just now you have also asked for more information. Well, the market rent should not exceed the monthly earnings of the age group. I asked this question and I raised the idea last time. I'm glad to see that they are picking up the idea. You better wait for that paper because we need further calculations. Let me read out the other questions if you don't want me to sort of waste time. Yes, please. How are you going to assess the eligibility of the tenants? What about domestic violence? What about victims of sexual assault? And what about wanting to live closer to one's workplace so as to save time and save money on the journey so that there will be time and money left for further studies? So I hope that the service operators will tell us how they set out the criteria. In the case of Shanghuan, I can imagine that I think it's best if you allow young people working at the vegetable wholesale market as well as the catering industry to live there. And then we have got two-person household units. So I expect young couples will live there. But what about if they have a newborn baby? Do they have to be evicted? How are you going to accommodate a young family with a child? And how are you going to make sure that they leave upon expiry of the tenancy? If they are not able to climb up the social ladder, I mean the housing ladder, to get a unit in the private market, what are you going to do? I think the service operator has to answer the questions. The government must also answer the questions. The administration should give us a paper. Now, we're talking about five different service operators. What terms and conditions will be included in the service agreement? Will all the service agreements be the same? It won't work. Ms. Ho, I think your point is clear. It has been said in the past. I could see that Mr. Law was jotting down your ideas, so I think he can provide more information after the meeting. Next, Mr. Sin Chung Kai, 4 minutes. First round, a policy issue. Now, the rent will be set at not exceeding 60% of the market rent, but then setting aside depreciation, maintenance, etc., there may still be a surplus. Are you allowing the service operator to keep the surplus? In case there is indeed a surplus, how are you going to deal with it? Well, in fact, this has already been answered. Mr. Law, please give a brief reply. Now, should there be a surplus arising from the operation? Well, in fact, whether there is a surplus, in accordance with the service agreement, every year money should be set aside for the purpose of maintenance because it is going to be a self-financing operation. Now, after making provisions for the maintenance fund, if there is still a surplus, then the service operator may apply to the HAB and have the surplus applied to other non-profit making users. The HAB will then take a general and overall look of the financial matters and try to see whether the use is applicable.
I have heard this answer before. So that means they would have extra resources. So why don't you put all the money into a big pool? Then other service providers can also apply to get more funds. Mr. Low, for the NGOs, we are actually asking them to make use of the sites they own for youth hostels. So we need to encourage the NGOs to take part in the scheme. So for both constructions and operations, they have to make a lot of efforts. If we can encourage more NGOs to take part in the scheme, then more youth hostel places can be provided and more young people can benefit. And for the NGOs, when they design and operate the youth hostels, we want the hostels to be designed and operated in a pragmatic manner. And if there is surplus, then the NGOs can use such surplus to enhance the services. This would be an encouragement for NGOs, and they will try their best to operate the youth hostels in the most efficient manner. As for the use of the surplus, if the NGO chooses to deduct rent if they have a surplus, we do not object to that. And also, that surplus can be used for other purposes so that more people can benefit. We also do not object to that. So the most important thing is to give them an incentive so that the NGOs will be willing to use their size. Right. Ms. Shen Yuanhan, I support this project. I have some questions. Now, for this youth hostel, that's actually another youth hostel in the last paper. And in that youth hostel, they have a common area and have kitchens, common kitchens, etc. And how about this one? And this youth hostel is quite close to the East Rail. Have you assessed the noise level? Mr. Low? I'll ask the Hong Kong FYG to answer this question. Ms. Amy Fong, as for kitchen, yes, there is a cooking place at our communal area or common area. So if tenants are interested, they can go to this common area and cook and talk with other people. As for noise pollution, all along we have been very concerned about this. So when it comes to the orientation of the building and the noise insulation facilities, etc., we have been keeping close contact with the EPD, and we hope that the noise level can be as low as possible. So when you talk to the government, has the government told you about the noise level? Maybe our architect can answer this question. Mr. CH Ng, with regard to noise assessments, we have talked to the Environmental Protection Department. We have also changed our layout plan several times. Now at night, the noise level is at 50 dBA. We have designed our building so that this level can be achieved. Well, just now I was told that there will be a kitchen. So how about a common area where people can talk? Well, because this is a youth hostel, so there is a place where they can have meetings and chat. Ms. Fong, on the second and third floor of the youth hostel, we have sub-communal facilities. They include sitting room. Young tenants are welcome to go there for reading, for chatting, for going online, and also there are laundry rooms and cooking facilities. So the kitchen and the sitting room together, yes, they are on the same floor. I still have some time, Chairman. I would ask another question. Now there are 78 units. How many are for one person? How many are for two persons? 76 of them are single rooms, and two rooms are for special purposes. Such rooms can be used by couples, or they can be used by persons with disabilities. Mr. Chang, I can 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. I support this project. But only 78 units can be provided. It's not a big number. And also the government is also having this project in four other areas. Now, this was first proposed in 2011. Now, 5 years have lapsed. If we still handle this slowly, then many young people may not be able to move into such hostels eventually. And now the government's policy is that if young people move into youth hostels, then they would have to give up their public housing right. Well, I object to that. I think first you should ask young people to move into youth hostels, and then they should be allowed to move into public housing and then eventually move on to private housing. You should give them an opportunity to move up the social ladder. And now if you say that once they live in youth hostels, they cannot move into public housing, I think this is counterproductive. They should be allowed to apply for public housing at the same time, because if they get a public housing unit, then they can vacate their youth hostel flat. Now, if you adopt the present policy, then over 90% of the young people would live in the youth hostel for 4 or 5 years before they look for another place to move to. Now, you still have a lot of time before application starts. So you should think very carefully about this policy. Will you definitely not allow these young people to apply for public housing? And also, this youth hostel is next to a youth center under the Hong Kong FYG. I hope that there won't be a labeling effect. I'm sure you know what I mean. If there is a labeling effect, then I don't think you will see many applicants. I hope the project can start as soon as possible. I hope the government will pay attention to these 2 points. Mr. Leung has already gone out, and then Dr. Kwokaki. Members, please pay attention to this. I have repeated many times today, for policy issues, they should be discussed at the panels. Today, I have allowed you to ask certain questions about policy, and Mr. Laurie Low has already jotted down your questions. After the paper, he will submit another paper to provide members with more information. If you have so many policy questions here, I don't think it's appropriate, and the PWSC cannot work if you ask questions in such a manner. Because for policy issues, they should definitely be discussed at panels instead of here. If you repeat your policy questions, we cannot move on, so please do not do that. Dr. Kwokaki, Chairman, a point of order. What you said just now is your personal opinion, right? I think members have the right to decide what they ask. You cannot say that certain questions cannot be asked. Dr. Kwokaki, this is very clear. This has always been our practice. We are all very clear about that. As the chairman, I have the responsibility to remind you. So you remind us, right? That would be okay. But now you're making a decision. You're saying that we shouldn't ask any questions of a certain type. Mr. Kwokaki, this is very clear. Members have asked a lot of questions about policies. I have tried my best to allow the administration to reply to your questions, and they even agree to give you a paper after the meeting. I'm the chairman. I have the responsibility to do this, and I hope you would respect my reminder. Now, if you want respect, you should respect other people first. I would like to ask about some figures. thought. And 150 millions have been spent on this 78 units. Some of our young people have no place to live. They have to live in subdivided flats. So if they are lucky, then they can live in this youth hostel, and each flat is about $2 million. It would be great if more young people can enjoy these facilities. But now the Hong Kong FYG is building a luxury building, and I really cannot support that. Well, young people hope that they can pay a lower rent, and I'm sure that for the young people who move into youth hostels, they are not looking for luxury flats. So if there are extra resources on the side of the government, it should ban such resources on building more units for young people. Has the government been monitoring this? How come $2 million is spent on each flat? For Hong Kong's NGOs, I don't know what is happening to them. How come they are doing things this way? And how about the management fee per square foot in the future? And does the management fee cover wages for staff? If you run it like a luxury apartment, then we will have to spend a lot of public money on that. I hope you can make all these calculations clear. Okay, first, Dr. Kwok asked about construction costs. Who's going to answer that question, Mr. Low? Now, for the Hong Kong FYG project, if we use the September 2015 price, then the construction cost is $23,000 per square meter. We have taken the site condition into account, and we find that it is a reasonable price. For each project, it would situate on a different site, so the condition of the site may affect the construction cost. This level is acceptable when it's compared to similar projects. What do you mean by similar projects? How about public housing? He's the deputy secretary. He's not the undersecretary. Well, we have looked at the university hostels and government quarters. For this youth hostel, because all the flats are independent, they have their toilets, they have their own facilities. So you may think it's expensive, but it's just a basic design. It's definitely not a luxury flat. We have always said that the NGOs should be building pragmatic flats, not luxury flats. How about a management fee? It's already included in the rents. There's no management fee. But how do you calculate that? And how about wages for staff? Are they at the lowest level already? Well, if a young person just makes $12,000 or so, what would happen? So how do you calculate the operating costs? As I said just now, we do not collect management fees separately. We are seeing that the rental level would not exceed 60% of the market rent of flats in the nearby areas, and the rent already covers everything.
It isn't about the level of the management fees, but then he would be interested in the operating costs and whether there's any monitoring. For the service agreement to be signed, they need to come up with a comprehensive financial plan, and it will be made public as to the specific items in the workflow I'm not sure if the Federation of Youth Groups can answer the question. Well, for the paper that you're going to supplement, please cover this point. That is, the factors to be taken into account in the future operation. Yes, I do agree with you, Chair. Yes, it will be run by the Federation of Youth Groups, but then the government has got a duty. It will be young people that are going to pay the rent. If the Federation of Youth Groups is not frugal, then it will be a problem. I think your point is clear, and the paper will cover this as well. The next, a number of members are not here, but then I give the floor to Albert Chen. 3 minutes. I subscribe to KK Kwok's point. It is said that the unit cost is 23,900 per meter square, but then it is alarming to see that the unit cost per hostel unit is $2 million. It's too alarming. Please show us the figures. I want to ask two questions here. First of all, what about your initial idea about the service agreement or the grant and operation agreement? I think, Chairman, you understand that audited figures would always show you a picture that no money has been made, no profit has been made. But usually a service provider can make money out of, say, management, or the DMC will say that the management fees will be of a particular level. And then you can also freeze you by having a security service agreement, a cleansing agreement. They can also make a profit out of the construction cost. So I'm interested in the land lease. Chairman, I think you will understand that in the past few years, churches and other charitable organizations have cooperated with large developers. They put down their own properties and then they redevelop the site into luxury flats. And then they make a profit out of it. Now, before we say yes to the funding request, we need to know about the terms of the land lease. Please show us a copy of your grant and operation agreement. Otherwise, you try to slip something into it. The site used to house a youth center. Now, with the youth hostel built, where will we get the youth center? Yes, it might be reprovisioned, but what about an interim? So where would the young people nearby go to? So please show us a copy of the grant and operation agreement. Mr. Chen, you talked about management fees. No, not the management fees, management agreement. You also asked whether for the management fees there will be an excessive level of management fees. Just now, Mr. Law, the Deputy Secretary, said that the rent will be inclusive of management fees. They may not charge the tenants for a management fees. When answering Dr. KK Kwok's question, Mr. Law has agreed to provide a supplementary paper. As to the youth center, it will be you will be on the ground floor. I move a motion to adjourn. Mr. Obichan, in accordance with the rules of procedures, that is paragraph 43, he would like to ask for the discussion of this item to be adjourned. There is paper PWSC 2016-17. Paper 10 in relation to paper 41QJ. He would like to adjourn the proceedings. Now, members may speak for not more than once. Each member may speak for three minutes. Please press the button to speak if you want to speak. I'll give the floor to Albert Chen first. Basically, I support the direction of this scheme. But then there are two important issues here. Before we approve the funding request, we have to be assured of the following. First of all, more than $100 million to be spent to get 70 plus places. Is it reasonable? I think it's better to give the project to the Housing Authority, and then it will be more cost-effective properly. So in terms of the policies, in terms of the operating experience, etc. Now, you are creating a new item, and then you allow this privileged group to venture into property development. I think it is absurd. Why don't you give it to the Housing Society, the Housing Authority, or even the URA? Why don't you give the project to such organizations? If the Hong Kong Federation of Youth Groups can do it on its own, so be it. Maybe we can grant the land in return for a concessionary rent. But you are spending public money on this project. I have no trust in the Federation of Youth Groups. I've been asking for the audited accounts, but they only publish the unaudited accounts. So a lot of things are unclear. And then they cater more for the privileged youth than the underprivileged youth. We have this youth federation because in the 1980s, in the center in Wan Chai, there was a disturbance. The British Hong Kong government fostered the youth work. And that's why the Federation of Youth Groups was able to call the tunes in the past 3 decades. Now, all the good things have been given to the Federation. In the North District, we have the historic building in the form of the Massachusetts building. The Federation of Youth Groups has got it, and it is used to host mainlanders. I'm interested in the land grant. We are still at a loss as to what's happening. We are merely asked to write a check. Of course, the chair has said that for this meeting, we shouldn't talk about policies. But then funding request is closely related to policy issues. Many questions have still not been answered. I think it's better not to block down the agenda. It's best to suspend this item so that we can move on. Next, Mr. Wu Chi-wai, 3 minutes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As far as the concept of youth hostel is concerned, there's no dispute. The question is how we should go about it. It is unfortunate that the service operator involved here is the Federation of Youth Groups. In fact, at the panel meeting, I already raised a general point involving other operators. Just now, the Deputy Secretary told us that if a young person lives at such a hostel and still queue up for public housing, it is tantamount to double benefit. But in fact, according to the scoring system, you won't get to your turn before the age of 50. So a young person has to wait for 20 years before being allocated a PRH unit. So what you have said is far from the truth. If you talk about disallowing double benefits, but how come that this organization, through this project, can get the surplus after deducting the maintenance, etc., so that the surplus can be applied to other projects under the of operator. It is double standard. For the young people, you are very harsh, and yet to the service operator, you are being generous. Well, the site has been sold to GIC, I think. Now you're going to have residential users, and they can get rent out of it. It is a form of revenue. So The public may perceive this in this way, that is, through such an arrangement, the land use has been transformed. For Edward Chen to say that we should adjourn the discussion, there are two advantages. First, we won't be standing in the way of the following items. Second, it seems that we need to be clear about the target. If you want the young people to be able to accumulate some capital, please consider whether a stay of 5 years will be adequate. I have grave doubt about it. Therefore, I support the motion to adjourn. Thank you. Next, Mr. Ray Chen, 3 minutes. Thank you, Chair. Well, sometimes more haste, less speed. You may think that we can quickly dispose of an item, but in fact, this item has generated many questions. I did follow this up at the panel meetings. I support the scheme in terms of its broad principles, but too little, too slow. You may say that our questions asked today are more related to the policy issues, but I'm afraid they are directly related to our decision to say yes or no. You have allowed me to speak, and I really want the administration to reconsider the case of setting the rental in relation to the market rent. I hope you shouldn't charge a higher rent in Central than in Yunnan. I hope you won't be a few times more expensive. Mr. Low, the Deputy Secretary, has said that it is up to the tenants to choose the district, and the tenants will choose an affordable rent. Is it a housing project? You say no, it's a youth development project. If you say that we should pack it to the market levels, then I don't think you should have it in Hollywood Road. Understand that it will be run by the Tua Group of Hospitals near Manmo Temple. Now for this project, we have got so many questions because this will be completed first and it will be accepting applications first. Now if somebody, if it is said that the young people should not be allowed to remain on the waiting list for PRH, saying there is double benefit, but what about the middle-aged? They don't even qualify for youth hostels. Can they apply for both at the same time, so that the young person can have a choice and he will just pick whichever comes first? And then for the surplus, many members have queried that. Now, we're talking about 70 plus places. Probably we don't look forward to a huge surplus. But then for a larger development, the surplus will also be more substantial. Here, we are giving them a lump sum to construct the hostel. Anything remaining after deducting the expenses from the revenue will be regarded as a surplus and it belongs to them. KK Kwok, 3 minutes. We agree with the concept of youth hostel, but then there are queries, there are questions. Please don't forget that this is public money. We are interested in the agreement. Do we know how the management fees are to be set? Now, 60% of the market rent. Now, this is not a commercial operation. No need to pay the land premium. No need to pay the construction costs. So when we talk about these rental being not more than 60% of the market rent, probably we are paying for the overhead costs as well as the salary. Once we say yes to this project, it becomes the policy. It's impossible to say that 60% of the market rent is about right. We want to know how much they spend on electricity and how much on water, etc. Young people need to save money. I think we need to opt for the minimum service so that they have more money left for savings. 60%. Please don't regard it as reasonable. It is 60% of the market range.
The problem is, where will the money go? If the money goes to the pockets of the Federation of Youth Groups, that is not what I want to see, because this is not supposed to be a money-making project. And what will happen to the application procedure? Would it really be open? And would the NGO have the authority to make all the decision? Like, it would only accept those people who would do voluntary work for it? Because for other projects, there won't be such a selection process. So would you look at the background of the applicants? Would you look at the young people and try to ask them if they are willing to work for your organization? Because I don't want this to set a precedent. Otherwise, in the future, all the youth hostels will be like this. That is, on the surface, you are providing them with accommodation, but underneath, the NGOs will be reaping benefits. I do not want to see this project blocking the discussion of other projects. So I agree with Mr. Chen Jiechun. I'm sure these projects will be discussed again here in the future. So I don't want to set a precedent. Well, for Youth Hostel Scheme, it was first proposed in 2011, and now 5 years have passed, and we won't see the youth hostel in 2 or 3 years, even if it's approved today. And if this project cannot be approved within this term, then maybe the time will even be longer. So we may have to spend 10 years before we can provide these 78 youth hostel units. Just now, the pandemographers have raised a lot of queries about this project. I also have some opinions about this project. For example, I do not like the policy that young people have to give up their rights to apply for public housing. But are the pandemographers really thinking for the young people? They asked a lot of questions. And is it that we must stop the project now before the questions can be answered? Now, even though we endorse this project today, it still has to be submitted to the FC, and the government can provide us with supplementary information before that. And if there are still questions remain unanswered, I'm sure the HAB and the Federation of Youth Groups will provide answers in the future. So I don't think we should have all the questions answered and get all the information before we endorse this project. I think we can adopt a two-pronged approach. So I do not support Mr. Ray Chen's adjournment motion. So Robert Chen's adjournment motion. When I answered other members, I already mentioned this. I said that this is a project that requires the cooperation of a number of parties. We also want to encourage more NGOs to take part in the YHX, that is, those NGOs that own sites. So for their future management and financial arrangements, they would be governed by the service agreement signed between the NGO and the government, and all the accounts will be open. There will be sufficient monitoring and transparency. Young people really want this kind of project, so I hope members can support it so that we can submit it to the FC and the youth hostel will be built as soon as possible. Mr. Albert Chen, well, for young people's demand for housing, I think we really want to help them. But does this project really help them? We are just talking about 78 units, and you have to spend over $100 million on that, and you are giving this pro-government organization the right to do it. So why don't you ask the Housing Authority and or the URA to do that? They have a lot of experiences. They can build many more units than just 78. So we really have to make sure that the money is spent properly. Are we going, if we're going to give funding to a certain NGO, is that NGO really reliable, and is the mode of operation efficient enough? If you ask the young people, do they want FYG to do this project for them? That's why I cannot support this paper. I now put the motion to vote status. This committee decides to adjourn the discussion of this PWSC item. That is 41QJ. Mr. Albert Chen asked for a division. The bell will ring for 5 minutes.
聽。各位，現在要
What we are voting on now is Mr. Albert Chan's motion. That is, this committee decides to adjourn the discussion of the paper PWSC 2016-17-10. That is the project about the youth hostel. Members, please press your buttons. Before I stop the voting, please check your vote again. Voting stops and I declare the result. The result is displayed. 29 members have attended, 9 yes, 19 no, 0 abstain. So we will continue with the discussion of this project. Let's continue. Let's see who will be the next member. Is Mr. Kwai Kang here? Kwai Kang? No, not here. Mr. Alan Lang. Mr. Alan Lang, second round, 3 minutes. Chairman, for this project, is one or is the first of the 5 youth hostels under the youth hostel scheme. So this model is very likely to be used by other youth hostels. So I want to make things very clear this time around. I have several concerns. I only have 3 minutes. I think I can just ask one question. Well, when it comes to the application, would there be a set of objective and fair criteria? Would that be also included in the government's operation agreement? Because I don't want the operator to add special conditions. For example, the applicants must be patriotic, the applicant is not a supporter of Hong Kong independence, etc. What I mean is that do you have a set of objective criteria? Will it be set down in writing? Where can I see it? And also, for the operator, you are saying that it will be operating the youth hostel in a self-financing manner. Well, it's not likely that the NGO will lose money. It's more likely that it will be making profits. So where will the profits go? The NGO itself will decide on the use of the profits. If that's the case, then it will become a cash cow. So would the government think twice about this?
And certainly, in relation to the rent, I think, Chair, you will understand that in the case of a public housing rental units, the rents are sort of standard. You don't see huge differences between a unit in Outer Court and a flat in Lok Fu. How come that here in this case, the rent levels would vary from district to another, from district to district? So try your best to answer my questions. Some of the questions have been asked and answered, Mr. Long. Regarding the surplus, it is a self-financing project. So should there be a surplus, and whether there is a surplus, we still ask for funds to be set aside for future maintenance, and should there still be a balance after that, it can be used for cutting the rent or applied to other uses. subject to the HAB's approval. As to the eligibility of the tenants, I think you can include the answer in your supplementary paper. Today, we haven't got time for that. Next, Dr. N. Jiang, for the first time, 4 minutes. I opposed the motion to adjourn. This is because for the youth hostel, there is a strong demand for youth hostels, in particular by singletons. I do have strong views here. For us to get a youth hostel in Taipu District, it would be a good idea. I've only got a question here. This is because ...35,000 square meters will be for the purpose of the hostel, but only 78 places. In other words, each flat will have 400 to 500 square feet area, and then we are talking about $17,000 in 2014. It may be $18,000. We're talking this target group, and yet the rent they're going to pay would not exceed 60% of the market rent. Would you consider having more units instead of just 78? Is it possible to have 150 so that you have more units, those smaller ones? Now, if we talk about one person household each occupying 500 square foot and they only pay 60% of the market rent, land is a scarce resource. I think the idea of the youth hostel is to help them to become self-reliant. So I think it's better to have more units. I think Ann Jiang's calculation is wrong. I don't think it is 500 square foot for a one-person household. 10 to 15 square meters for a 1P household. For the details, I can defer to the Federation of Youth Groups. Miss I. For the 78 units, 76 are for one person, and then the area would be 15 to 16 meters square. Where we have got two units for special cases, and it will measure 30 square meters each, and we have got in mind people with disabilities. We have already maximized our plot ratio. We need to provide support facilities as well. And Jen, yes, I've noted the figures. Please go to paragraph 4 of the paper. It is said that the total construction floor area is 4,040 square meters, including around 3,460 meters square for the youth hostel. So 3,460 meters square. Have it divided by 70 plus units, won't you get a figure of 400 square foot? Well, even for private developments, you need space for the common areas and other facilities. I would defer to our architect, Mr. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, the site is small. 402 meters square only. We need to meet the requirement of site coverage. Only 35% can be used to accommodate the residential tower. The efficiency will be 66% in the case of a private residential development. Our ratio is a bit lower than that in the private sector because the orientation of the units is such that we shouldn't face directly the rail track so as to lower the noise nuisance. And then We therefore can only have 5 units per floor, each measuring 10 to 15 meters square. Please go back to paragraph 4. Please revert it. Your time has run out. I think the paper is clear as to the design as well as the flat area. If you have further questions, please follow up with Mr. Ng after the meeting. Next, Mr. Michael Tian. 3 minutes, second round. Mr. Chairman, when I spot a problem, I won't give up. And I will go back to my earlier point. I think you're discriminating against those who are from the lower income group and those who have a lower educational attainment. You've told us that once you get a place in a youth hostel, you need to give up your status in the waiting list for PRH. As long as you are on the waiting list, you are accumulating points, and then it is a matter of double benefit. Why should I give up my place in the waiting list? I might have been in the queue for 3 years. I get a hostel place. I don't think I should give up my 3-year waiting period. I think the most you can do is to freeze my status. Let me stay in the queue. Maybe I live in the hostel for 2 years, 4 years, or 5 years. You just freeze my status in the waiting list. When I depart from the hostel, then let me resume my status in the waiting list. Why would you want my status in the waiting list to be removed altogether? Mr. Low, I can only repeat what I have said. There was a lot of discussion internally in the administration. Responsible officials have said that given the weighting mechanism and the point scoring mechanism, you can't answer the question. I've only got 1 minute left. Earlier on, you sounded fully justified. I'm a person who is reasonable. Yes, when you're in the queue, you will be sort of gathering, accumulating points. You try to defer to another department. I think it's impossible. Mr. Tian, please let Mr. Liu answer the question. It involves different policy areas and it requires coordination. Now, the administration has said that we would like to have 3,000. I'm talking about the principles, don't talk about the figures. Mr. Tian, well, it is a matter of getting to and fro. I know what he's going to say. I've got 20 minutes. You have 20 seconds. They want to answer your question. Please respect them. Well, I think what you're saying is that you haven't thought about it and you try to defer it to another department. Please try to think what the other department is going to say. If you don't freeze the status in the waiting list, I'm not going to support it. I cannot agree that I try to pass the buck to others. It was discussed, why not freeze this waiting list status? Now, even if it is frozen, you can still score the points. And then we may be talking about two groups of young people of similar background. Both have housing needs. For one group, they're able to get a place in a hostel and they are given assistance in youth development, while the other group, owing to one reason or other, cannot get a place in the hostel. If both groups are allowed to score the points, I'm talking about freezing it. Even if frozen, they are still able to score the points. Next, Mr. Lan Kwok Hong. No, he's not present. So, Mr. Albert Chen. 2 minutes, third round. I'm concerned about the case of the land lease because in recent years there are just too many NGOs and in particular religious bodies cooperating with the conglomerates instead of providing social services and in fact many religious landmarks which carry our collective memories have disappeared. and in its place we have got luxurious flats. So we've just seen too many examples. Therefore, in this case, I'm interested in the land lease. Of course, this won't happen in 10, 20 years. But what about the long term? How can we be sure that the landowners and they will get public money, they will make profits, but sometime later they may think that the profits are not generous enough and they want to pull down the hostel so as to make more profits. Can we be assured that this won't happen at all, Mr. Liu? There is an agreement to be signed between the government and the service operator. There are restrictions on the use of the site, and within the agreement duration, if there is a proposal to demolish, how long? 40 years. In other words, they can do so in 40 years later. They are still subject to the restrictions of the land lease, and I think it will be bound by the planning intention. What sort of restrictions? Bound by the land lease. Do you know the terms and conditions? The land leases are different. Please supplement the information. Yes, include this part in your supplementary paper. Next, Fernando Zheng. 3 minutes, second round. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For such youth hostels, to me, I think it is a matter of hypocrisy. You have a scoring system for the PRH waiting list. And then for young people who have a lower level of income, they have to wait until the age of 50 to get a PRH unit. I think they have been sort of denied the chance as a result of your gimmicks. Now for the youth hostel scheme, altogether there won't be more than 3,000. So it's a matter of winning the Mark 6 lottery. You'll be very happy if you get a place in the hostel. So it is just peanuts in terms of the welfare. But of course, there's no way that we should say no to your paper. The property market is such that everybody is suffering. Today, for a young person to rent a place, it will be very difficult. So it would be a good idea for you to come up with the youth hostel scheme. However, you are not resolving the problem at the core. You just try to give us some window dressing. You are not taking it seriously, and it is not of a large enough scale. The site is housing a youth center. It is a very small site. Even if you exert your best efforts, it will become a pencil building with only 70 plus units. It will look odd. As to whether we should give it the green light, yes, we should. For the LegCo to talk about policy issues with you, to talk about the difficulties in meeting the housing needs. Now, you just come back with this very meager project.
And these projects have to be self-financing. The scales of different projects are so different. For the Polanco project, you have more than 1,000 units, and this one you only have 78 units. Do you have an overall plan for the young people today? It's so difficult for them to get housing. So this is what you do. So you want to change the scoring system and exclude them, and then you ask them to join this lottery, and if they are lucky enough, they can get a youth hostel unit. So only a small group of young people can live in the youth hostels for a few years. So this is what the HAB's youth housing policy is, Mr. Low. As for youth housing policy, it is an inter-bureau issue. Today, we are talking about youth development. We want to provide youth hostels to help young people of different ages. Members, I would like to reiterate, according to Rule 37 of the Rules of Procedures, if members ask questions concerning the topic, they must be related to the project itself. If you want to talk about policy, you have to discuss that at the panel meetings. And the chairman will always refer to the rules of procedures. So for policy issues, please discuss them at the relevant panels, or you can even raise them at the council meeting. Today, we have already asked the administration to jot down your questions, and he has promised that written answer will be provided to you. Mr. Lam Kwok Hong. Well, back then I asked questions about the link. I asked how come the properties had to be sold. I was criticized. The chairman also told me that I should ask such policy questions on other occasions, and now they are selling off their properties. The chairman doesn't want us to talk about policies. Okay, so I have a simple question. How do you calculate the construction cost? This is about public works, right? So how did you make the calculation? So construction costs should be packed to the rental level. How did you make the calculation? So I will work in accordance with the chairman's instruction. For construction costs, it's not packed to the rental level. And for the calculation, I will ask the FYG representative to answer. Is Ms. Fung or? Well, I'm complying with the chairman's instruction. I'm asking questions about public works. What a waste of time. You want us? Mr. Sin from the ASD, actually under paragraph 12, there is an explanation about the construction cost, mainly about foundation and superstructure, and also there would be furniture and equipment, consultants fee, contingency fees. That is not construction cost, that's operation cost. Well, how much of the area is usable, and how is that packed to the rental level? Well, the construction cost is not packed to the rental level. And now if you want to ask about construction cost, I will ask our ASD officer to answer the question. As for the setting of rental level, Mr. Lam Kwok Hong, Mr. Low has answered that question many times, and he will be providing a more detailed paper to us after the meeting. Next, Mr. Ray Chen. For the setting of rental level, I just asked a very clear question. Now you are saying that it's back to the market rent. Why is that? What's the purpose of doing that? If it's back to the market rent, it's different from taking the market rent as a reference. And you are saying that it will not exceed 60% of the market rent of flats of similar size in the nearby areas. So the NGO will be looking at that. Some members asked the NGO to do it more cleverly, or this will be done by the government. That is, the government will be providing the reference rates to the NGO. And after deciding on the rental level, then for the 5 years, the tenant would have to pay the same level of rent, right? So after a tenant moves out, what will happen to the rental level? Or will the rental level be adjusted every year in accordance with the market rent? So would the rent be adjusted on a yearly basis? Well, I think it ties in with the contract. During a whole contract, the rental level, the rent will be kept at a the same level. And after the contract, the rental level may be adjusted. How long is the contract term? The first contract should not be shorter than 2 years. Afterwards, the NGO can choose 2 years or 1 year. The NGO can take a reference from the valuation and rating department's numbers, and also in the course of doing that, the NGO can also seek the help of valuators. Mr. Wu Chiwai? Well, for the young people who apply for youth hostel places, they should not enjoy double benefits. Now, the NGO provides a site and it gets a building from the government, but the operating surplus can be put in the NGO's pocket. So the NGO itself is enjoying double benefits. Can the government explain to us about the advantages of such a policy? Now, maybe you should just build public housing on that site, and the lower three floors would be used as a youth center. Would that be a better option? I think there is a basic consideration. For these sites, they are not owned by government. We hope that NGOs would use their own sites to join the scheme, so the government cannot force the NGOs to use the sites for certain purposes. Now, they are operating in a self-financing manner, and if they have surplus with the permission of the Secretary for Home Affairs, the surplus can be used for other purposes. For example, they can reduce the rent of tenants, they can provide services to tenants, and also they can use it for other services. So can the surplus be saved and then give a rebate to the tenants when they leave? Well, the NGOs can choose to do that, but the government will not force them to do that. If they choose to use the surplus for other services, they can do that, because this will be a bigger incentive for them to join the scheme. Before going to the FC, would you give us a paper on how the NGOs will use their surplus? We have told you the principles. Yes, I can give you a paper. We will discuss with the two NGOs, and if they have thought about how they, if they have decided as to how to use the surplus in the future, we can tell you. Well, the meeting is supposed to end at 10:30, but we are still discussing this, so I want to extend this meeting by 15 minutes. Would you agree? No? So we will have to end the meeting at 10:30. Dr. Kwakaki? Third round, 2 minutes. I have two questions. First, I think this is a very confusing policy. Now, if you want to provide housing for the youth, you of course want to accommodate as many young people as possible. And $2 million per unit, you are telling me that these are not luxury flats. I won't believe you. This is public money. I think the young people would like to see more units, more tenants there, instead of living in luxury flats. For the young people living there, luxury flats meaningless because they are just living there for a short time. And Mr. Law says that the HAB can allow the NGOs to do whatever they want with the surplus. What kind of logic is that? So if the Secretary for Home Affairs thinks that the NGA's proposal is acceptable, then it would allow the NGO to do whatever. But I think the surplus should be used to help the tenants, for example, giving them a rebate or reducing the rent. So what kind of logic is that? I don't think the government should do that. This should not be used as a gift to your friendly organizations. So for the future operating expenditure, it must be spent on the operation and maintenance of the youth hostel itself. Mr. Albert Chan? Well, for construction works, I think experience is very important. I don't know what kind of experience the FYG has. It's not a developer. And what if there's a cost overrun? Do you have an agreement on cost overrun? Will you come back and try to get more money from us if there's a cost overrun? And how about giving us a breakdown of the area? Would the FYG make use of this opportunity to expand the youth spot? So can you tell us which part is the youth hostel and which part is the youth spot? Well, when it comes to the design and the areas of different facilities, I think they can provide us the information after the meeting. Well, please give us the information as soon as possible. So it's about time that we adjourn the meeting. And we should end our discussion here. Next meeting, 18th of May, Wednesday, 8:30 a.m. Let's adjourn the meeting now.